100 episodes ago, we were at...
We were at 26.
26.
Yeah, that's what happens.
It's crazy.
Wow. Mathematician Hill over here.
That's my strong suit.
It's like hanging out with Stephen Hawking, minus the wheelchair.
You know what we talked about on episode 26?
What did we talk about?
Batman versus Superman.
And, oh, did we really?
Pregnancy, empathy, and schizophrenia.
100 episodes, we talked about Batman versus Superman, pregnancy versus empathy, and what was the other one?
And schizophrenia.
Schizophrenia, okay.
That's right. Probably when I went into my whole thing about how schizophrenia is, they're just on like a higher level.
Yes. Dear God. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, wait, no, you Cody covers genetic schizophrenia.
Yeah, I read an article in the New Yorker at the time about an individual who's talking about what causes some of these mental illnesses because it is a hereditary thing.
Right.
And it was passed down from his uncle had it, and he had an aunt that had it, and his grandfather had it or something like that, and they were all having it, and he believed that his father might be close to experiencing it, and he was happy that he wasn't experiencing it. But what I think it came down to was that there was a plaque buildup on the nerves, and what normally happens in your body is this plaque is maintained and cleaned. And this has been a while. God, this is a long time ago. But in this scenario or this article, he was saying that the plaque isn't maintained and cleaned or something like that.
Interesting.
Unfortunately, I can't like give you an exact, if that's the one that I'm thinking that it was, then
and
yes.
The other topic was William Shatner has a kid who's seeking money.
Of course, why not?
Why the fuck not?
I don't remember any of those things. I do remember my excitement for Batman versus Superman.
You were into it.
I was really excited for it.
I was a skeptic.
And as you should have been, and you know, looking back on it years later, it is a disappointment.
It is a pile of dog excrement.
It's garbage. The movie's garbage. But I love Superman, so I can't help but love Superman. And I'm a fan of Batman, so.
You got to love him.
You got to love him. And Ben Affleck was a great Batman and Bruce Wayne.
Okay, that's arguable.
All right, well.
Fast forward. 100 episodes.
Dan's got a baby. I'm married to a woman. And
you have a dog?
I've got a dog, and Dan has a...
And a haircut.
Yep. Yeah, lots changed.
Lots changed.
Well, thank you, and hold on tight for episode 126, where we talk about nothing that we just spoke of.
This is the Dan and Cody Podcast. This is it. Right here, Cody. You put on those headphones, and you go to work.
Why are you yelling?
This is where our message is heard.
It's time to get hype. Say it with me.
What are we saying?
Dan and Cody.
Dan and Cody.
Dan and Cody.
Meet Dan and Cody Podcast.
Dan and Cody Podcast.
Dan and Cody Podcast.
Get some.
Dan and Cody Podcast.
Cody, my boy.
Dan, my man.
What is the word on the street? How you feeling? I feel good.
You know,
feeling good?
I feel pretty good. I'm dealing with some anxiety, I think. I'm feeling anxious.
I like that.
And it's an odd thing where you feel tight in your shoulders.
Mm-hmm.
Like you're thinking about things and it's just tight and you just can't get loose. And like I'm driving up here tonight and I'm thinking to myself, man, I'm just anxious.
Well, you got to use it.
I have this anxiety in my body right now. And all I'm thinking, all I'm imagining is standing at the top of a mountain and looking out and being like, in those moments where I'm in the middle of nowhere and I'm looking out, there's no calmer moment for me.
Mount Vesuvius?
Well, not even, no, I'm not saying like a volcano. I'm just saying like you get to the top of a hill and you look out and you have like some picturesque kind of vista. Right. Mm-hmm. And you're looking out to this picturesque vista and it's just you. And I'm just thinking to myself, I'm like, God, that seems so nice right now. I want to go up to the mountains. I want to get lost. I want to stand atop a mountain and look out at some picturesque vista. And I just want to feel not anxious.
I would hate that.
You'd hate being anxious or you hate a vista?
If I got to like the top of a mountain and looked out, all I would think about is, fuck, we have to get down from here.
Down's easy.
No.
I'm not saying you like fucking
Down's a pain in the ass.
No, it's not.
For a long period of time, down is a pain in the ass. You want to know how I know?
You go down twice as fast as you went up.
Yeah, but it's a different kind of going bed down than up.
So you're telling me you hate going down. You'd
don't
rather
like going
go up.
Down.
You'd rather climb the mountain than walk down the mountain.
That's right.
This is insane.
That's right. Well, I'd rather not walk up a mountain at all because I like to do other things.
Like what?
Well,
give me an example.
What?
Give me an example of something that doesn't involve other people and you by yourself that you like to, well.
Play video games.
Okay.
Lay on the beach.
So all of these things involve you not walking up or down a mountain.
Right.
Yeah. So it sounds like it involves you not walking at all.
No, it's interesting because when I ran the Los Angeles Marathon.
You did that. I've never heard you say that you do that. Oh, wow. What a real winning moment for you.
On March 18th, 2018, Daniel completed the LA Marathon.
Yeah.
Running downhill was a challenge because it like fucks up your legs. You're using different muscles. It was very strange. Didn't like
yes.
it.
Yes.
Did not like it.
Yes, it does.
So I think you should channel this anxiousness and
yeah.
use it as positivity and motivation to confront whatever it is you're anxious about.
Well, you know, and I mean, and to be frank and honest, there's several things that I feel anxious about, but it all comes down to like looking yourself in the mirror,
yeah,
and being like, okay, so what are you?
I'm a you're a goddamn champion. That's what
wow.
you are.
Yeah, you say these things about being a champion, Dan, and they're just words.
No, they're not.
Yeah, man.
Literally.
I'm sorry, but the champion mentality is fading from the old codeman.
Oh, Jesus, buddy. Come on.
Dude.
I gotta wrangle you. All you have to do, even if you don't believe it, it's just you keep saying it, and then you will.
So are you a champion?
Fuck yeah.
Yeah.
Every day.
This is like, I just so everybody that's listening, hanging out with Dan is like hanging out with Tony Robbins.
I'm on one of those Bowflex things right now.
Yeah, exactly.
Just like kicking my legs, like, you know, swinging them.
The only difference is he doesn't have the giant hands, and he doesn't look like Andre the Giant like Tony Robbins kind of does.
I'll sign every book in here for
That's
you.
That's absolutely right. Oh, look
I haven't
at this.
I haven't written any of them, but
this
I will
is my
sign
biology
it.
Book from 10th grade.
That's
signed
right.
by me. Here you go.
That's right.
Right.
Well, I'm just saying. If you know you're having identity issues, you need to look in the mirror.
I don't know if you know, it's funny because I, you know, when I have periods of time where I work really a lot,
mm-hmm.
I don't have time to think about it. And I'm really focused on it. And then what happens is when all of that busyness kind of comes to a screeching halt, then I have these moments, my wife will tell you this, where I have these moments where it's like I stop.
Yeah.
And now I'm thinking about it and I'm like, shit.
Yeah.
What's happening?
Yeah, you stop and think. Everything
it's
calms
like,
down,
right?
And you have time to like reflect, and that's
right.
not always great. I get what you're saying,
right,
man. Like we do this as humans. When you actually stop and think about your life and responsibilities in this world, and your work and all this stuff, it's scary, and it's best to just let it happen. Because when you think about it, like car, rent,
boat,
dog,
second boat,
baby,
motorhome,
my tax scam, the drugs that are coming in from Guatemala,
my hairpiece,
yeah, do I have Zika?
Right, exactly.
Like it all like builds up, and you're like, shit, how do I live this thing?
Right.
But then you just like, oh yeah, do it. I am responsible for a child, and I have $25 in my checking account. Sweet.
Sweet.
No.
Looks like she's going to get buttered noodles again.
That's right. Hey, Mox, hope you like spaghetti, because it's for everything.
Right.
No, but yeah, you can't do that. It's great to reflect. Not great to dwell in
right,
the reflection.
Right. Don't dwell in the reflection. You know, one of the things as I was driving and I'm thinking about this mountain where I feel calm and the true serenity, right?
Uh-huh.
I'm thinking to myself that it'd be great. I just went completely blank.
It would be great as you were thinking about the mountain.
Yeah. As I was thinking about the mountain, it would be wonderful to get some perspective.
Mm.
You know? It's in that weird way. Like, one of the things I really like to try and do when I have moments is really kind of try and step outside of myself and be like, okay, so here's you. This is you. It's like your self-mirror in a strange way.
Yeah.
How are you approaching things? How can you do things different? How can things be different for you?
Mm-hmm.
What are you wanting right now? And there's too many times that I second guess what I want, and too many people in this world do that. So get out there, know what you want.
Get out there, know what you want, know what you do.
Yeah,
know what you're willing to do to get what you want.
Absolutely.
Because if you're not willing to do the things that you know will get what you want, then you don't want what you think you want.
That's true.
Yeah. I had the opposite today. I was a little frustrated, a little stressed about going back to work.
Yeah.
And I just got in my car, and then I immediately did that thing about like how you're on this earth and you're nothing, you're small. There's the problems that you are having are stupid, and there's like a big universe, a billion other universes, and shut the fuck up. And then I was like, today's going to be a good day.
Wow, that's pretty good.
Doesn't fucking matter.
That's a good way to approach it.
Yeah.
You know, I'm thinking about it, and we're like talking about this, and then right over your shoulder here is Michael staring off into the distance. There's this photo of Mike, the guy that our lovely producer, editor, mix man. There's this photo of him just staring off into the distance.
Yeah.
And he's just, you just see like from his midsection up to his head, and then there's the sky and the city in the background, and he's just staring out.
You got to be like Mike.
Being a, you know, thinking about the world outside, you know.
Be like Mike.
Anyway, it's crazy, but that's kind of what I've felt recently.
Yeah.
And another thing.
Hmm.
Tell me about hair, man.
Hair. I hate hair.
Body hair, specifically. Does it feel like when you wake up and you get out of the shower and you look in the mirror and you think to yourself, I don't remember growing this body hair.
Yeah.
It feels like one day it just appears. And it's kind of like with pubic hair. Like one day I just had it.
Since 25, I've been Teen Wolf under clothing.
You've been that hairy?
Yeah, I'm a hairy son of a bitch. But I hate it. I hate hair.
So how do you manage it?
Well, I shave my head every 3 days now.
You shave it every 3 days?
Every 3 days.
Because it just gets...
Well, a little stubble comes out, and then I don't like the pattern baldness. So the only way to get rid of
the
pattern...
You don't want to show it.
I want no subtlety of that fucking like, oh, he's missing it there. So you have to keep it skin. So that's every 3 days. Trim the pits.
You trim your pits.
Sometimes I just shave it off.
You shave your pits.
Yeah.
Man,
otherwise,
you're progressive.
Otherwise, it'll connect to the chest.
No, it doesn't.
Yeah, it's fucking Teen Wolf over here.
I've got it. My chest hair is like a pitiful T, in the sense that it runs from both of my nipples to the center of my chest, and then it slightly goes down. It's not even a T. It's almost like a. It's like one of those weight balances, and it's got the base there in the middle of my chest.
Like the symbol for lawyer?
Yes, exactly. That's right. That's what my chest hair looks like. And then obviously my facial hair is super patchy. I look like Steph Curry with a beard.
I think you have a full full 5 o'clock shadow.
I wonder, I'd be curious to see. I have no desire to grow a beard.
Yeah.
But because I hate it, because it makes my face itch.
A beard is very hard to manage. The misconception about the beard, though, is that people don't get past the step. They don't get past the itchiness. Like, yes, when you grow a beard, it becomes itchy. But after like 2 weeks of that itchy, it's gone. And then it becomes nothing. So then you start getting like the full thing, and you don't even feel it. But a lot of people are like, I just can't get that far. It's always itchy. And they think it'll just always be itchy.
Man.
You just got to get over that hump.
That's not ever going to happen.
Yeah.
This is like, I was going to shave it this morning. This is as long as it gets.
I got the ear hair, too.
I'm starting.
Ugh, it's horrible.
I don't know if we talked about this. Did we talk about my ear hair?
Maybe.
I don't know. But it's thick.
Yeah.
It's not that it's in thick patches. It's that the hair is wiry.
Mm-hmm.
Like wiry like I've never experienced.
Dude.
It's like nose hair wires.
Yeah.
It's that kind of wiry hair.
I'll be feeling around my face.
Right.
And I'll feel just a strong thing of hair, it feels like the lead in your mechanical pencil.
Right.
And it's like hard as fuck. And right. I'm like, God damn, that spike is growing out of my face.
Terrible.
But the ear hair, yeah. Do you have like a shaver with a bunch of different
I don't. Clips? I don't have one of, those. What I like to do is I like to pull my ear hair.
Ooh, okay.
Individually.
All right. That's something to talk about.
Yeah. I like to pull it out and I like to...
with the therapist?
Yeah. And I put my hands in and I just pull at it.
Yeah.
You know.
I'll do that with a nose hair if it's too long.
I do that
long,
with nose hairs that are long, that too. Yeah, I like to do that too.
You got
to
get one of these.
Sneeze. I love to sneeze.
You got to get one of these like mini manscaping razors. It's not a full like buzzer like you would buzz your hair with, but it's like a small one. And it comes
it's like a face trimmer.
Yeah, and it comes with a lot of different
attachments.
Attachments. Yeah, there's one that looks like a pencil.
Okay.
You just clip it onto the thing. And shove it up your nose and it'll just zap.
Does it
all.
Do a good job?
You have to,
I have a nose hair trimmer, sort of, but it gets so warm when it's up there. I don't think the motor's meant for my type of nose hair.
Mine works.
Oh well, okay.
I'm a hairy bitch out of my nose, and I do it on the ears.
Okay, you hear it when it goes in the ear.
Yeah, I like it.
Okay, cool.
Makes me feel good.
Yeah, man. You know, body hair is a weird thing. It's so odd, and to think like.
Today's man has to trim.
Today's man has to trim. Yeah, that's right. We live in a metro world.
Yeah.
And, you know, you got to make sure you're clean.
And a lady who's like, oh, my man's hairy and I like it because he trims it.
Yeah, because he keeps that shit clean.
He keeps it clean.
He doesn't make it look like he's like, you know.
Yeah.
Robbing a, I don't know, whatever somebody with gross hair would rob.
If you can see your man's dick.
What?
Soft, he trims it. That's what's up.
I'm not even going to add to that.
You're welcome.
You're welcome.
Ladies.
Yep, so make sure he trims it. Anyway, whatever. My gosh.
But that's how we deal with hair. I don't do the legs.
Yeah. I read the news all the time, and it's... It's odd because it actually distracts me from reading like books. I listen to NPR all the time. And like this is like affecting the way I make choices.
That's why you're looking in the mirror like, what the fuck? You're getting bogged down with bullshit.
Yeah. I mean, I was driving here. I was listening to jazz.
Oh, yeah. I saw a couple of your grams that are like.
Oh, yeah, yeah, exactly. I was just listening to some. I've been on a real, like, you know, instrumental jazz shtick these days. I found this great album that I've listened to like a dozen times. It's pretty good.
I told Michael I don't like jazz, and he got personally offended.
Michael likes jazz?
Michael loves jazz.
Good for him.
I told him that it just sounds like a bunch of mistakes.
Oh, my gosh.
And me and Jenny were in the car. It just sounds like people are fucking up.
Well, it's kind of that idea of like, it's almost like improvisational music where you're kind of playing off of the other person and you're working and it's all about feel, man. It's all about mood. It's all about mode.
Jazz has been hijacked by the same people who hijacked wine drinking and by the same people, by the same motherfuckers who hijacked like beer tasting.
Just so you guys know.
These smug assholes.
What Dan is doing, what Dan is actually doing is Dan is doing like subtle racism because what he actually means is white people.
No.
Fucking hijacked jazz.
That's not true.
And wine and fucking, and beers.
No, I'm saying that hoity-toity pretentious assholes have taken jazz and said, like, I know what jazz is.
I don't know what jazz
you
is.
You don't. Like, they say, oh, do you like this? Yes, this is great. What this actually does is it...
You see how they move from a B chord and straight into a G?
Right.
You can't just do that from a B chord to a G minor.
Right. They're like, I've been listening to B.B. King since I was fucking 12. Come on, darling. Let's have another martini.
Cheers to this beautiful glass of Cabernet.
Yeah.
If only it was a little more like a stout IPA, right?
Yeah. Let's go to the jazz festival in Baton Rouge, shall we?
That sounds delightful. Maybe we'll
stop down at the French Quarter and have ourselves a sweet piece of cheese, if we will.
Tweet up. Oh, yes, that was a harp.
Yeah. Oh, love those harps. Beautiful harpists.
But I was me and Jenny, we were on the way to Grandma's, and there was an interview with H. John Benjamin, the voice of Archer and Bob's Burgers.
Yeah.
And Jenny told me a story that he would do like a comedy bit that no one knew was a comedy bit, and he'd go to these places with a jazz band, and they would all be playing like real jazz, and he would just fucking whip up some bullshit on the drums.
So Jenny's,
he put out
saying,
a full jazz
Jenny's
album.
Jenny's saying he put out a full jazz album. I should have learned what?
I should have learned how to play the piano.
Oh, and it was called I Should Have Learned How to Play the Piano.
On all the tracks, and it's professional.
And I guess it's professional done across the board, but it's like
he played piano on the entire album, nonsense. And he's just like boom, 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 boom. Yeah. And could anyone recognize it? I don't know. A lot of people would be like, oh, yeah, I know how to spot bad jazz.
Oh, that sounds like really great jazz. Yeah. It gives you the chance to not know what's coming. Yeah. And it allows you to really feel the music, be a part of the music.
Right. When you hear the piano, make sure that the wine you're drinking hits your tannins. Simultaneously.
Make sure that this wine has a load of tannins. A load of tannins, Dan.
Yes. I'm getting back on my old soccer team, my old outdoor soccer team.
Okay.
I'm pumped. This league is outdoor instead of indoor. I've been doing a lot of indoor. I got new boots.
Yes.
I got new gear. And if you look, I'm a firm believer, if you look good, you play good.
Okay.
So I'm really excited to get back out at night running with my homies, my old team.
Okay.
Playing against tough competitors at the highest of co-ed athletic sport.
Now,
I'm pumped.
You do it because you appreciate the competitive side of the sport, yes.
Yeah.
Like, that's why you're doing this.
And I like...
Like, you're not LeBron James. Like, you're not going to get paid to ever play soccer.
Never. But I like...
You do it because you enjoy to play. Just like I like to play basketball, you like to go out and kick a ball around.
Yeah. I like the this league keeps stats. It's like...
Oh, they do?
Yeah, it's like fantasy sports, but I'm in it, you know?
Are you a defender or do you
I actually, play D. Yeah.
You play D, so you're not the guy scoring the goals.
Right. I stop them. I enjoy being like the stopper. I play sweeper.
You're like the Bash Brothers in Mighty Ducks.
That's right. I play sweeper. Sweeper is for those of you who don't like soccer or don't know anything about soccer, sweeper is basically free safety in the back.
Yeah.
Like you end stuff, you know.
Really?
You're the last line of D before the goalie. So it's your sort of thing, like, all right, like I'm not really
like the next guy that has to stop this guy's the goalie, and we know he's not any good.
He gets by me, you're getting a shot on goal.
Right.
That's basically what's up. And if you get by the free safety, you're gonna score. You're about to score a touchdown or something like that. So in a lot of ways, my job on the field is not necessarily to like to create.
Okay.
I'm not a good creator of like plays, you know, but I am good at like, this is last ditch effort. I'm good at that. Like end this, like get the ball out of bounds, get this thing away, break this thing up,
yes.
Cause commotion, be that guy. It's like almost like a Birdman, you know, on the Miami Heat.
Okay. Yeah.
Like he blocks shots.
Yeah. He's just everywhere. You want, wherever you're going to be, he's going to be there.
Right. Or like you're Shane Battier. Or your
Shane Battier.
He was known as a
3-point threat.
Well, and just like a tough defender.
Oh, right. And what, he shaves.
What's so his name on dick. What's his name on frickin' he was on the Memphis Grizzlies.
Shane Battier.
But he was their defensive specialist.
Oh, Delonte, no, not Delonte. It was Tony Allen.
Tony Allen. Yeah, it's sort of like Allen. That. sort of like that. But I'm super stoked. I got new boots. Like I said, they're like state of the art. Thanks, Dad. That was like a birthday gift. But they've changed so much.
In what way?
Since I've gotten new cleats.
The boots have changed?
Yeah. Like they do this whole like over ankle thing. They're really like snugs you in.
So you feel like you're going to play better because of this?
Yeah.
Really?
Firm believer. Equipment plays a major part on your mindset going in and your psychology.
So are you generalizing here, or are you saying equipment that's for everybody?
I think it's for everyone. I think psychologically, like let's say you're like, hey, I'm gonna go work out today, and you put on like your old sweats, they got barbecue sauce all over them, they're ratty, you put on your shoes that you mow the lawn in, they're green, they're fucked up. You're going to look at that. You're going to be working out in that. You're going to feel sluggish.
Okay.
I think like
there's something to be said about, it's kind of like dressing for success.
That's right. Exactly. You wear a suit every day, you know, you're going to be official. You're going to be like, your posture is going to change.
Absolutely.
You know, you want to work out, you want to get a good workout in, you're going to put on your freshies. I used to buy a pair of tennis shoes that I could only wear if I was working out. I still do that with my running shoes.
Okay.
My red ones, I only wear those to work out. So it's like a reward, you know? It's like, I want to look good. Well, I can only look good wearing those red shoes. I better go for a run, you know?
Okay. I respect that.
Throw on your fresh Under Armours.
It's as much a mental game as it is a physical preparation and being ready and wearing the right gear.
Yeah, that's right.
Like nobody's going to walk out in a soccer game wearing
some bullshit,
wearing pads,
yeah,
and a helmet and like feel like they feel comfortable that they can actually compete.
Right,
you're going to look like an idiot.
Your shin guards suck. They're all bulky and exactly. Fucked up. Nah. You got to look. You got to play the part.
Not on my watch.
You got to play the part.
You're the man now, dog.
You're the man now, dog.
You're the man now, dog.
Losers whine about their best. Winners go home and fuck the prom queen.
Oh, so much fun.
But that leads into what I want. The first thing I wanted to get after, freaking J.R. Smith, bro. Game one of the NBA Finals.
Uh huh.
For those of you, this isn't going to be a very sportsy thing. This is just, I feel bad for the man. And to be honest, I am rooting for the Golden State Warriors.
You are?
Yes. But what happened in this instance, it was the end of the game. Cleveland was down by one. And there was a foul.
Yes.
George Hill was at the free throw line and needed to take two free throws, one to tie, one to go up.
Yep.
George Hill takes one of those free throws, makes it. The game is tied. I think there were, what, like 4 seconds left?
Yeah, 4 or 5 seconds. You got enough time to get another shot off if he misses.
Right. So George Hill takes the second free throw, misses.
Yes.
JR
gets an offensive rebound.
Offensive rebound.
On the lower block.
On the lower block, which if you guys don't understand basketball, that's not easy.
No.
It's not an easy thing to do.
Just so you know, positioning-wise, he's like 5 feet from the hoop.
Yeah.
And he decides to run it out to the three-point line away from it.
Yeah.
Time's counting down.
And LeBron, the leader of the free world of basketball, looks at J.R. Smith as he's going away from the hoop like, what are you doing? Shoot it. Put it up.
Right.
Or like, pass it. And J.R. immediately looks at LeBron and he's confused. He's like, what? And so he just passes it down. There's some terrible shot in the corner.
By George Hill. He can't get it off. It's basically blocked.
Right. And I immediately, the game is over and it is tied. And I immediately, once the second he got that rebound and ran the other way, I was like, he thinks they're up by one. Like, this is a clear mistake. He thinks they're up by one.
Right.
And, I mean, they go on to lose the game in overtime.
Right.
But what I wanted to talk to you, Cody, about is it, I don't think that this is his fault. This is not just one person's fault. If you want to win the game, then George Hill, buddy, you got to make that free throw. If you want to, if you, and if.
Well, it's like this. It's like, it's kind of this idea. Okay, say somebody guard at the, just so everybody knows, at the end of the second quarter, time's counting down. Steph Curry runs up, launches a 3-point shot from like fucking half court and drains it.
As he does.
If the game goes as it does, and they go into the second half, and they stopped him from taking that shot, which they gave him wide open, and you know, he just throws the ball up and it goes in magically. Cleveland wins that game.
Yeah.
Cleveland wins that game. So you're right. To win the game, it's not one mistake.
Yeah.
It's a series of mistakes that are made. And unfortunately, Cleveland didn't help themselves.
Right.
It was impressive that they stayed that close the whole game. And if they would have won that game, you can make the argument that this is a series. But at this point, it's done.
It's pretty much...
It's 4 to 5 games total. Yeah. That's it. I don't think Cleveland's going to win a game.
You think they'll get swept?
I think Golden State sweeps them.
Wow. Because of this, do you think that this one thing, that mistake, has set them on a path of just we've blown it?
I think there's a mental thing for Cleveland that they have to overcome. And I'm not saying they can't do it, but honestly, even if they overcome the mental thing, Golden State's just that good.
Yeah.
Their team is unfair.
Yeah.
Across the board.
Well, the problem is...
Like, did you watch Steph Curry in game two?
Yeah, he's
incredible. He had 4 or 5 shots where it was just like, he could have grannied the shot from the other end of the court and it would have went in.
Yeah.
It's stupid how easy this man makes a long distance shot look. And it's, to be honest, it's offensive.
It's not, you're offended by his greatness.
I'm offended how easy he makes it look, because it is not that easy.
Well, look, now I disagree with you, because look at Tiger Woods. Tiger Woods used to make it look effortless.
Yes.
Then he got hurt. Then he stopped having sex with everybody.
Well,
and now it looks very hard for Tiger.
Tiger got a mental block, and that's why he did it.
Yeah.
And Tiger was tapering off big time before he got.
He had all the surgeries and stuff.
He was having the surgeries, but it wasn't even the surgeries. Essentially, what had happened was what he brought to golf
mm-hmm.
caught up to him.
Yeah.
So by that, what happened? Tiger changed the way golf was made. Tiger actually came out to the course. Tiger was driving it 60, 70 yards further than everybody else.
Yeah.
He was hitting the ball harder, and his putting game was on par. And what happened was all of these things forced golf courses to expand the length of their course. And meaning like par fours were now longer, par fives were even longer. They made it harder for the players. And now what's happening is now you're having the young guys in that watch Tiger. And all of these guys can compete and play at Tiger's level because they've all been playing at that level.
And now Tiger's physical attributes have caught up to
him. And this is something that's going to happen in the NBA, where you have a guy like Steph Curry and Klay Thompson, and you have these guys that are just draining swishers.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be surprised if I see an extension of the three-point line. I wouldn't be surprised if they bring it back.
Nah.
It's too easy, man.
What I was trying to get at was that Steph, the way he makes it look effortless, he practices that. Like the crazy shots you see him take, he's taken that shot in practice 50 times on Tuesday. Yes, he does.
And LeBron does the same thing. Like when he won that buzzer beater.
Yeah.
He says he practices shots like that all the time.
Does that shit all the time. Yeah. Right. So like this is not, it's at this point, I mean, no one can say that this is luck. Those guys are just good. And the thing with Cleveland is, so many things have to go wrong for Golden State for Cleveland to win by a little. And,
yes.
And so many things have to go so right for Cleveland.
To win.
And Golden State, they really have to screw up
right.
to lose.
You're absolutely right. And that is why Cleveland is very unlikely to win a game. I want them to win. I want them to win the series.
Yeah.
I want them to tie it 2-2. And who wins the series? Because honestly,
it'd be fun
if LeBron wins this series. This is one of the greatest playoff runs to watch from a individual standpoint.
He's great. He is so freaking good.
And if he's able to beat them, he's Jordan-esque. He's a GOAT. He is GOAT. There is no doubt about it. He is GOAT. If he wins, if the Cavs magically beat Golden State and they win the finals, he's the greatest of all time. You can't argue it.
It won't happen.
You can't argue it. It won't happen. But if he does it and he ends up winning all these games by being LeBron James, I don't know how you argue him as not the greatest player of all time. Because when he's on the court and the way he's able to take a team down from 11 to get them up into tying the game mm-hmm. with Golden State, there's something scary about that. That's Jordan-esque, man.
But
he's just not getting them ahead.
It just cancels out. Like
yeah, it does.
The
There's nobody Golden else State, on that team that can help him.
They can get you six in like
two 20
seconds.
Right, yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's true.
My question to you is it JR? It's not JR's sole fault, is it?
No, it's a team game, man.
Do you think he deserves...
George Hill should have made that free throw. There was no excuse for missing that free throw. George Hill makes free throws like that all the time.
There's all kinds of blunders in sports.
From a team standpoint, like, why is there nobody else on the team saying, it's 107-107. It's 107-107.
Right.
You get it. If the ball misses, and I get it, you don't want like, to mess up George
conversation.
Hill. So, it's about team communication on the court. It's 107-107. You get the ball, get it out, shoot it.
And
call a timeout. Do something.
That's a coach thing, too. Out of timeouts, coach should be like, hey, one timeout. We have one timeout.
Right.
And score.
Right.
Check the score.
Right.
You should know, but it's like, check the score.
Right.
I don't think Teron Lue's a good coach. There was no adjustment in game two.
No, it's the same. It's the same game plan.
It's hard.
The one thing they did do is they were a little more aggressive. I've said that if J.R. Smith actually is aggressive as a player, he's aggressive and Kevin Love are aggressive. I think they do have the potential to beat Golden State.
And Four times?
JR, no, I meant the last game.
Okay.
And JR was aggressive right off the bat. And if he is aggressive, that's a good thing for them. I think if all of their players are more aggressive, George Hill was more aggressive, they need to be more aggressive against Golden State. I like that actually what their game plan against Golden State in game one was the right game plan. Slow it down.
Mm-hmm.
Golden State runs off a rhythm.
Mm-hmm.
And the minute you give them they're good at like fast break, they're good at moving the ball around,
mm-hmm.
you have to slow them down so that they're not on offense as much. You shut down the number of times they get to shoot the ball.
Mm-hmm.
When you do that, you control the tempo, and if you can match them shot for shot to some degree, which Cleveland did in that first game.
You can't miss. You don't want to miss with them.
I mean, there's a reason LeBron scored 51 points.
Yeah.
And it's because... he was matching them shot for shot because he realized I'm limiting the number of turnovers. I'm also limiting the number of shots that this team takes. I think it's a smart game plan.
Yeah.
You can't go full tempo, you know, old Phoenix Sun style where Steve Nash is running the point. It's not that game.
Yeah.
They're an ISO team.
You also got to get like a Dellavedova type player to just bother Steph everywhere he goes.
Right.
That was the only reason they won the first time.
Well, yeah, that and Kyrie Irving.
But guys, y'all act like you never made a mistake at work. And that's what this was.
Big mistake.
JR made a mistake at work. And it's unfortunate, but we all do it. And it ain't his fault entirely.
No, it's a team game, man.
And then they're like, oh,
they
overturned the charge. It's fucking rigged. Don't be that guy. Don't be that guy booing the rules.
Right.
They can look at that play.
Yeah.
And they can change it if they want. If they were in bed with Golden State, they would want Cleveland to win that because they're favorite. They would make Cleveland win game two then.
Right.
You know?
Meh.
It's fucked up.
Move on. Let's just get over with. Golden State wins it. We can get on with our lives.
Hello there, Dank Odies. I am Joe Merle.
And I am Phil.
And together we are Those Movie Guys Podcast here with your weekly movie recommendations. And this week, Philip, I am going with 1979's Meatballs, the Ivan Reitman classic. I think this is just lighthearted Bill Murray. I believe it was marketed as Animal House at a summer camp. It's not quite Animal House.
Not quite Animal House.
But it's still a ton of fun. It's just with summer in the air, I think it's just it's a good time. And so that's my recommendation. And what do you got for us this week?
I pulled from Joe's bag and I went with 1976's Rocky.
Nice.
Even after a rewatch, like, I think it's just one of them stories. It doesn't matter the time. You can have the same story now. It's just the relationships he forges and just the struggle of the coming up, you know, at odds against himself and his old lifestyle.
I think that was the tagline. His whole life was a million to one shot. Rocky. And it's still
so
good.
That's why I went with that. I feel like it's timeless.
It is. It's a great one. So that's what we've got for you this week. We've got Meatballs and Rocky. So give those a go. And for those Movie Guys podcast, I am Joe Merle.
I am Phil.
And we will be back next week with more movie recommendations.
I was listening to the Joe Rogan podcast. He had Kevin James on. Kevin Smith. Did you listen to that?
No, I saw a post on Insta where Kevin Smith was sitting there with Joe Rogan and they talked for like 2 hours.
He talks about the heart attack.
And okay, the Widowmaker?
Yeah, that was a very, very interesting of like the symptoms, like what happens and all this shit and like what was going on. But what I took away from it is this crazy diet that I think I'm going to try.
What's the diet?
Potatoes.
Absolutely. I've heard of the potato diet.
2 weeks. Only potatoes.
Okay.
Do you think you could do it?
Absolutely. I love potatoes.
Do you want to do it?
Sure.
You down?
Like, what's the limitation on our preparatory? You can't use butter.
No, nothing. It's just a potato. You can bake it.
I can bake it.
Yeah, but you can't bake it in.
I can boil it.
You can't put it and put salt on it or cheese or butter or anything.
Yeah.
It's potatoes for 2 weeks.
Okay.
Kevin Smith lost 20 pounds. I've been fighting with the same fucking 20 pounds for forever. I got really down when I was doing all the training, but I put some back on. Of course, I can't keep up that running obviously for like forever.
Right.
And I still eat like a fucking 17 or 15 year old.
Yeah, I'm the same way.
But and he got it from Penn Jillette, the magician.
Uh-huh.
He did 2 weeks potatoes.
He lost 20 pounds in 2 weeks.
Kevin Smith did.
Yeah, he was a big dude though, naturally.
He was big, yeah. I don't think we'll have the same.
No. I mean, I'm on the calorie diet, man. I've lost 20 pounds since March.
For real? You do look a little slimmer, man.
I was 20 since
March?
I weighed in at the beginning of March. I was 193 pounds. I went on a calorie diet where I just managed the calories.
And no exercise?
No, I didn't really have any exercise.
Limited exercise.
I mean, I like maybe play basketball periodically, right?
And you're up on your feet working and shit. That counts
for
stuff.
A lot. I move around a lot. But, you know, it's not like I'm running. I'm not. There are days where they're a little more physically demanding, but for the most part, it's not.
Right.
But it's all calories. So what happens is I'm on a two-week-a-week loss. So I would be limited to 1,600 calories a week. Or 1,600 calories a day, to give you kind of an idea.
It's not a lot, man.
It's not a lot. I feel bad for women because it's even bad. Like my wife was trying to do it, and they're like cutting her down to like 900, 1,000 to lose 2 pounds a week. It's not.
Are
that's
you kidding?
Not even manageable. I don't know how a woman.
What
does
is that? A grape?
Right. Exactly. And so I'd go down, and right now I'm sitting at 174 from 193.
Good for you, man.
So my goal is 165, but the last 2 weeks, I haven't been very good about it. I actually stopped taking measurements because I was out of town and it was hard for me to like manage my regular diet because I couldn't control what I was eating.
Right.
So, you know.
Good for you, man.
But you watch your calories, you lose weight. Like I got too big. 193 pounds for me is huge. It's the biggest I've ever been. And at another point in my life, I weighed 184 and I said to myself, wow, buddy, you need to take a step back, bro. And then I went on another calorie diet and I ended up losing. I got down to 169.
Wow.
So my idea, I'd like to be at 165.
I want to get to 220.
Okay.
220, I would be very, that would be like pre-college Dan.
Okay.
220.
Well, man, I'm telling you, if you do the calorie stuff, you cut out sodas.
Yeah, I'm done with a regular soda.
Yeah, well, diets, you know.
I'm on these.
Diet's the no-calorie drink, but I don't really know what that means. How it tastes like that
weans.
Without it.
Yeah.
It's got something. It's got to contain something. You stay away from salt. You drink a lot of water. You lose a lot of weight.
Yeah.
But I mean, truthfully, as long as you eat natural, it's hard to eat 1,600 calories of salad. I promise you.
This potato diet, it's not really that bad. What they say, because potatoes contain a lot of water, so yeah, you end up peeing a lot.
And it's starchy.
And it's starchy, yes. People are like, oh, that's so bad for you. But, like, potatoes provide a lot of nutrients for you.
Right.
So, like, it's not one of these things where it's like, dude, after 2 weeks, you're going to die. It's really, after 2 weeks, you're not going to like potatoes much, but...
The only reason I don't want to say I don't want to do this diet is because I absolutely love potatoes.
And by the end, you might be like,
and I don't want to not love potatoes. It is one of my favorite foods. I love potatoes so much. It is like a staple in my diet.
Yeah. I think I'm going to do it just to save money. I've never done one of these big fad diets.
That seems like a fad diet. I'm curious to see how it works out for you. You know, aside from like me counting calories, I don't, you know, like I had a buddy at one time. He went on this like weird, like liquid diet where he had like chili powder and whatever it was. The cayenne pepper diet, and he lost a ton of weight.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Really fast.
But that was fucking people up. Like,
yeah, of course it was, man.
They called it like the cleanse.
They put like maple syrup in there. There's nothing in that. There's no nutrients for you to sustain yourself, to have any energy to do anything all day.
And you're like, man, Melvin, you look great, but you're a dick.
Yeah, exactly.
You're very hungry and mean to everybody.
Right.
But yeah, I think this will get me very irritable.
It's terrible, man. You probably should just count your calories.
I just eat potatoes.
All right.
I don't want to count them.
Why? It's interesting. Because you actually learn.
I hate math. I used to do Lose
You
It.
You don't have to. That's what I use.
It's fucking annoying.
I use Lose It, man. And when you account your weights, it reduces the amount you need.
Then you work out and it like knocks it all down.
Right, exactly.
What happens is I buy like a Subway sandwich and I'm like flicking through the thing. I can't find the cheese. And I'm like, fuck it. Is this even real? What is my life right now?
They've done a pretty good job of making it so it's like one entrance thing. I will tell you that. Like, I use Lose It.
I used to have to, I remember like I'd go to Chipotle and I'd have to be like, rice. And then I'd have to go back to lunch and be like, chicken. And then I'd have to go back to lunch and be like, tomatoes. And then I had to go back, and it was like five different clicks, and I was like, fuck this. I know what I ate. God damn it.
That's right. Chipotle, you know, 1,200 calories.
Yeah, bingo.
Yeah.
So I think I might try it. If anyone wants to try it with me, let me know. We could start together.
You know, I wouldn't mind doing the potato, but I love potatoes so much, I can't do that.
You can't commit to it.
Yeah.
Cody, one day, we got to do like the same challenge.
Right, absolutely.
Well, Cody, I have a new segment. Do you remember? I told you about this one day.
You did?
Yeah.
What's the segment?
This.
What would Kanye do?
No.
Oh.
Cody, for several podcasts, used to get so mad at me for my true crimes.
Yeah, because they're not true crimes, man.
Because they were always an animal hurting a human.
Today, a goose attacked a man in a park. Who's the killer? The goose or the government? True crime.
Dun, dun, dun. Yeah. So now, I'm introducing a new segment called When Animals Attack.
So you're telling me we're going to have a weekly segment about animals attacking something?
That's right. This one's actually great. And this is why I, to this day, will not hike.
I don't understand. Like, this man goes for runs, but he will not hike, which is one of the most pleasant things.
Hiking is for losers. It is for idiots. It is for people who like dirty socks.
Dan Hill just called me an idiot.
You enjoy the hike?
I enjoy a hike in the woods.
It's weird walking.
Why is it weird walking?
That's what hiking is. Hiking is weird walking.
Like, you don't... Where is the explorer bone in your body? If I was to tell you there's gold up in them hills, and I said, somebody buried treasure up there, And I said, I got a map, Dan. Are you interested in going? Your ass would be like, nah, man.
I'd be like, fucking helicopter, nah, drop man, me up there.
Yeah, no, like I'd probably just... Like, I'd max out my credit card for a helicopter ride up
there. Can I reverse zip line up there? Right, exactly. Is there an Uber?
That's terrible.
But here we go.
Okay, here we go. When animals attack.
Rabid coyote attacked a man in Jones County, and he attacked back.
What's Jones County?
Jones County, it's a forest.
Jones County is a forest?
Yeah.
Oh, really? Is it right next to... Sherwood Forest.
That's right.
Sherwood County.
Nate Edmonds. He's an attorney from Geico in Macon.
Now Macon, Georgia. So this is in Georgia.
Yeah.
Okay.
He went hiking, right? And it was just a typical day, and he saw a coyote.
Okay.
Just chilling. Okay. What would you do if you saw a coyote just chilling?
Probably nothing, because for the most part, coyotes will not attack people. They will attack babies, and they'll eat your baby and run off into the woods with it.
Would you just like kind of turn around and walk away? Or
I've
would
seen
you,
coyotes. I mean, yeah.
You're just like, whoa, hey, little doggy.
No, I mean, you know, just whatever.
Whatever? I'd be scared as shit.
What are you scared of?
That they're going to freaking eat me.
If you are aggressive with another animal, it's going to be aggressive with you. If you're not, for the most part, you're probably safe most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, so this rabid coyote, which rabid animal is aggressive without you being aggressive.
He tried to clap and yell to scare it away, but it had no impact. He then tried to go around it, give it a wide berth, and the coyote came at him, and it latched onto his boot.
Okay.
It lashed on his boot, this fucking coyote. He falls backwards.
Okay.
And the coyote then gnaws at his leg, bites his freaking jeans. He's got bite marks through his jeans. So he pins the coyote between his legs. He pins it.
Okay.
Pulls out his knife and stabs that motherfucker between the shoulder blades.
Okay.
This man murdered a coyote defending his life.
Well, I don't know if murder is the right word, but he killed a coyote in self-defense.
Right. Which is murder.
So just so people...
Self-defense murder.
To give people an idea, if you've never seen a coyote, according to Google, just so you have some size relation here, an adult can weigh anywhere from 15 to 46 pounds.
That's a big...
And height-wise, it's 2 to 2.5 feet. Dude, McFly is going to be bigger than one of these guys.
A coyote?
Yes.
Man.
McFly is going to be bigger than a coyote. Yeah, but coyotes
what? They eat human flesh.
No,
McFly
man.
Does not eat
no,
human
man.
Flesh.
They don't eat human flesh. If a rabid animal is rabid, it is an aggressive animal, and it is like crazy in the brain. So it attacks, and then it spreads the virus, rabies,
mm-hmm.
to you through its saliva.
Guys, you all have a chance of getting bit and killed by a coyote if you hike. So let's just
You have a very small chance of that happen.
Call it what it is, no. And everyone stop hiking.
We have done this before with rabies, Dan. You realize in the United States in 2015 there was one case of rabies.
For the cure.
Rabies. For the cure.
My next run is going to be for rabies. Yeah. The rabies run. Here's what this man says. He says, people need to be prepared, but people don't need to be afraid. He said, I've been in the woods my entire life, hunting and fishing and hiking and exploring, and this is the first time anything like this has remotely ever happened.
Mm-hmm.
So he's saying this is a safe-ass place. Meanwhile, he's up in the woods murdering coyotes.
Yep. You can be in safe places and crazy shit can still happen. But it's very unlikely and it's rare.
And that was when animals attack. Cody, how do you deal? What is your advice for someone dealing with a breakup?
What is my advice for somebody dealing with a breakup?
Yeah, like let's say one of your buddies, he came to you, Cody, man, it's over.
If somebody has a breakup, I think it's tough. You know, in the past for myself, whenever I had a breakup, you know, you got to give yourself some space. You got to give yourself some time.
Yeah.
And then you got to go get some strange.
Then you got to just go right back at it.
Go right back at it. Get yourself some strange. But for the most part, like, that's a tough one, man.
Yeah.
You know, I hate to, everybody's different in the way they handle these types of things.
Mm-hmm.
The real question is why did it end?
Yeah.
Did you do the ending? Did you get dumped?
Let's say this person got dumped.
If this person got dumped, you know, for the most part, like when that happens with me, I just want to hang out with my buddies.
Yeah.
Right?
So you're on the like, get away from it.
Yeah. Like hang out with friends. Don't dwell. You can't help what happened. If that's what they don't want, that's what they don't want. You don't control their wants and needs. You just have to move on, man.
Yeah.
I mean, we've all had our heart broken.
One of my big bad breakups, this was in college, a summer in college, me and my girlfriend, we broke up, and it was during the summer, so I went back home, I was staying with my mom, and all I did was like be depressed. I watched all of Friends, because she had like all the Friends box sets. So they were my friends for the summer, and then I just ran outside, and I would do push-ups and sit-ups. And then the goal was to like go back to school and be like way hotter than her.
Interesting. And so that you was took like, it personal, like you wanted that was to the motivation. Get her back.
Yeah, like you gonna miss this.
Right, right, right.
I'm gonna come back, and you gonna see new and improved, and you're gonna miss me, bitch.
Right, right.
But scientists have mapped out the best strategy for getting over a devastating breakup.
And what's that?
They did a study. They asked one group to do nothing. That was the control. Just don't do any of the suggestions.
Don't get some strange. Don't hang out with friends.
Right.
Don't watch Friends and do a bunch of ab workouts.
Right. There were one group was asked to think of the past relationship positively.
Right.
Of like, think of the good times, understand that this was a part of your life, accept it, and but to think of the good times.
Right, right. Yeah. Right.
Another group was asked to think about all the bad shit.
Okay.
Like how much they sucked, how terrible the relationship was, how stupid it was, and basically like get mad. And this other group, they were asked to use mental distractions. So they would be unable to focus on the heartbreak at all. So like they were told like, just get away. Like you were saying, hang out with your buds, don't worry about it. And then lastly, I already said the control group, they were asked to do nothing.
Okay.
And the situation that worked the best was thinking about the negative of how much the person sucked.
Interesting.
Yeah.
And I imagine there's a lot of people that actually approach things that way. I tend to be a little more self-reflective in those moments, and I ask myself, like, okay, this happened. How can I be better for it? Why did it happen?
Yeah.
And what's tomorrow going to look like?
Yeah.
I don't know. It's tough, man.
It suggests that negative reprisal is an effective love down regulation strategy, whereas distraction is an effective positive emotion up regulation strategy. So the next time you're enduring a tricky heartbreak, the research shows that you can use negative reprisal as an occasional method for weaning yourself off those pesky feelings of longing. But if you want to face the heartbreak without the negative connotations, you can be confident that acceptance will make dealing with the situation steadily easier.
Right. I would have to say that, you know, me moving away from Idaho was because of heartbreak.
Oh, really?
It was my motivator.
That was it.
It's time to change my life.
Yeah.
That's what it was. Best thing that ever happened to me.
That's fucking awesome.
So, you know,
Game on. While I was running...
Yeah.
During that summer, I was like, fuck that bitch. You know?
Wow, really?
It's just
I don't get like that.
You know I'm motivated by like doubt and like anger
right.
and like get back at-ness.
Right.
I need somebody like I had like that person in my mind like I'm going to beat you. I am going right. to fucking win, conquer. Like it was so like juvenile like I'm going to go back to school and everyone's going to think I'm hot,
right.
bitch.
Right, right.
But yeah, I mean
she's going to wish she never did this to me.
That's right.
Yeah, I get it.
So guys, girls, if you're breaking up, they're saying it's cool to have a seance outside, light all the pictures on fire, and just have a...
Whatever you got
to
do to...
shit on them.
Move on, man. Move yeah. on. Life's too short.
Yeah,
that's
man.
That's the biggest one. Life is too short, man.
That's right. Hold grudges.
I want to tell you about a company called JC Roomblocks. Do you have 10 or more out-of-town guests coming to an event near you? Maybe you have a bris, a wedding, a family reunion, a science convention. Maybe some friends are coming in town and they just want to get drunk in one place. Or your mom's coming into town and she's got 10 brothers and sisters and they need a room so they can all come over to your house and have a bagel. Well, I have the answer for you. JC Roomblocks. They research hotels in the area that you need the rooms. So if you're in San Diego, they're going to find those rooms. They're going to put them together for you. Oh, what? You need to be in Boston for a little bit? No big deal. Go over to Boston and hang out with your Boston friends. You got 10 or 15 of them and you need a room? Fucking Boston. That's what you're going to do. Since they're certified travel agents, they can get you the lowest possible rates. On top of discounted rates, they can also negotiate highly discounted bridal suites, shuttle service, and food and beverage functions. If you mention the Dan and Cody podcast, that's us, they'll waive their fee. That means you don't pay anything, okay? Check them out, jcroomblocks.com. I'm going to repeat that, jcroomblocks.com. They're on Facebook, they're on Twitter and Instagram. Follow them, check them out, get all them rooms! You heard of the marshmallow test?
No.
You haven't heard of the marshmallow test?
Does it have anything to do with s'mores?
No. It could, but it's not. So I saw this thing on YouTube or this thing on Facebook. Somebody's, you know, everybody's reposting all this crazy shit. And this, this like Japanese American physicist, maybe you've heard of him. You've probably seen him. He's got white hair. He kind of looks like an Asian Doc Brown.
I've never seen
his name's like Hideki Sumatsu or something like that. I don't know his name. Anyway, so he's presenting this idea of like children and intelligence. He's like, you can be as intelligent as you want all day. But really what it comes down to is the effort and energy you put towards something. And he said, one of the things you do with a child is, and it's also about being patient, right? He's mm-hmm. like, is you do the marshmallow test. And the marshmallow test is you ask a child, you give them the option. You say, I will give you one marshmallow now. Or if you wait an hour, I'll give you two marshmallows. And the marshmallow test is children that tend to be more successful, which I don't know the numbers or statistics behind this thing, by the way. I think he was just spouting this thing off. He said children that say that they'll wait for the two tend to be more successful in life, you know, however we judge that or determine that, because they're willing to wait for things to come to them,
mm-hmm.
and they're also willing to wait for the most opportune time.
Interesting.
What do you have to say about that?
Well, I know, if I know myself, I would have said, I'll wait for the two, but then halfway through waiting through the two, I'd be like, nah, never mind, just give me that marshmallow.
Right.
Because
right.
I can't wait.
Yeah. Well, here's what I'm going to do to this guy.
Huh.
I'm going to teach my kid to take the one and figure out a way to get another two from this son of a bitch in an hour. what a resourceful man does is he says, you know what? I'll take the one, but I'm also going to figure out how you have all these marshmallows.
Yeah.
And I'm going to make sure that I get two in an hour, four in 2 hours, eight in 3 hours.
What about the kid who's like, I don't fucking like marshmallows.
Exactly.
Keep them.
Exactly.
I don't really like marshmallow.
I mean, do you think that there's some validity to this idea that...
I would think that the
from a logical standpoint, I think it makes sense, right?
Well,
I mean, you're more thoughtful about it. You're more patient for things to happen.
I guess the kid who waits sees the bigger picture and and the payout.
Right.
But there's something to be said about a child who just like, who is like, I want that. I don't want to.
Right.
I want one now because I'm hungry for a marshmallow now. Give me that.
Yeah.
I'll get another one later.
My tastes and preferences could change, but it's a bigger picture thought. It's not about the marshmallow as much as it's about that desire to fulfill immediate wants versus saying, okay, Dan, you can have this dope-ass t-shirt that's got two bears cuddling now, or if you wait an hour or you wait a month,
mm-hmm.
you're going to get a box of t-shirts that have all kinds of assorted things of your favorite, you know, pop culture references of all time. Are you going to wait a month?
I'd totally wait a month.
Yeah, of course you would.
Well, now I would. But, I mean, I was in high school. I had a bond that my godmother gave me, and it was going to be like 1,000 in like 10 years, or it was going to be like 300 now. Do you think I did?
You went out and cashed and got 300?
I cashed that motherfucker at the nearest bank.
Right, exactly.
Got that 300.
Right.
But like, yeah, I mean, there's something to be said about people who live in the now. Live in the now, man.
Yeah, there's people that are that very much that way. You're right.
Seize your moment.
Right.
Like, you're like, well, this kid's like, maybe I won't be around
in an hour. Yeah, exactly. Life's too short.
Yeah.
Again, life's too short.
You make, like, there's all these freaking...
So many things, like, personally, on a personal level, I always wish that I could be much more patient in that way.
And wait?
And, like, not even wait, but, you know, you look back and you think, like, how would I have done things a little differently? Like, man, I would have paid more attention in school, and I would have, like, put my head in the books in things that matter.
Mm.
You know?
Yeah, I get it.
You know, and I think like when I see something like this marshmallow test, I think, fuck, man, I was that one goddamn marshmallow kid.
You would have done.
I probably would have done one marshmallow. Like, yeah, man, I want a marshmallow now.
Yeah,
I'm Veruca Salt.
I want it now.
I want
a pony.
Donuts and cronuts and things that make me go nuts.
Give it to me now.
Anyway.
Cody, I don't think there's anything wrong with taking the marshmallow.
I don't necessarily think there's anything wrong with taking the marshmallow, but I appreciate those people that would wait. My wife is I'm waiting for the two marshmallows. That's my wife. And that's why we're a good yin and yang combo.
Yeah, but you'll always be like, come on, let's do this.
I know. I'll push her into the one marshmallow.
What if the two marshmallows are like stale after you're waiting?
It's the risk you take to wait. You know, there's a risk, but there's risks weighed on each one.
It's a very open-ended scenario. Like, how long are we waiting? What's the wait?
Yeah, exactly.
Is like, the wait 5 minutes? I'll wait 5 minutes.
Right.
How about that?
No, but I mean, he was giving it an hour with the kids.
And what did he look like? You said he looked like Asian Colonel Sanders?
No, I didn't say Asian Colonel Sanders. I said an Asian Doc Brown.
Oh.
I like still. Asian Doc Brown Back to the Future 3.
Well, still, he's probably creeping the kids out. And like, I don't want to sit here for an hour with you.
Maybe. I don't know.
You weirdo.
He's an interesting guy. He's talked about like other universes and stuff like that. He's really cool. I've seen him on Discovery Channel.
Who's cooler, him or Neil deGrasse?
They're both pretty nerdy.
I like NDT.
I like Neil deGrasse quite a bit.
He's the man.
He's a good dude. Big fan. So, are you ready?
Ready for what?
This week's
True Crime!
All right, Dan. So, for the first time in a while, I have brought forward a true crime.
Cody's submitting the crime.
I'm submitting a crime, and I want people to know when I submit a crime, it's a real true crime. And it's so true right now, and it's happening right now, where we don't have all the answers. So this is going to leave you guys with some questions. And I found several websites that had information. But in Texas, a 19-year-old man and his girlfriend have been arrested. And they have been arrested and charged with hiring a hitman to kill his father, who owns a jewelry store.
What?
So apparently what had happened is in March, his father was killed in a break-in in his home. His father was killed and the family dog was killed in a break-in in the home. They haven't caught who killed the father yet. However, they have found out that the security cameras in the home had been erased for the time period where that killer went in and killed. And the only way to do that is if you have access to the online thing to erase those. And they found that it where it was logged into was this 19-year-old and his girlfriend's home.
You can't beat the internet, man. No,
and this was in Austin, and they basically were arrested on account of criminal solicitation to commit capital murder. And apparently this kid was supposed to receive a large life insurance policy, and he was going to be taking over his father's successful jewelry business.
Is that enough to pin him?
That gives you motive.
It's like the IP.
It gives you motive to why he would have hired somebody to kill him. Also, there was another website that this is from Fox News that I'm reading here, where it said that he claimed that he would receive an $8 million life insurance policy on the death of his parents. His mother survived. She wasn't killed. His father was killed. The dog was killed. And apparently another website I saw said that he would actually receive a $2 million life insurance policy in the event of his father's passing.
What kind of fucking creepy son are you if you're willing to kill your dad and dog over money?
Right.
That is worthless. More like you said 19-year-old man, more like 19-year-old punk bitch boy.
Yes. So he, you know,
how was the dad murdered, gun?
Actually, that's a great question, cuz I don't. They found him. I think he was shot. Yeah.
He was shot.
Yeah.
I wonder.
Yeah, he was gunshot. They said it was gunshot.
And in a situation like this, do they even try to hunt down the person who actually did the deed? Yes. Of course, right?
Yeah.
And would that person be charged with murder as well?
Well, the person that committed the crime would be charged with murder. The person that orchestrated it and paid for the murder would, I mean, I don't know.
They'd
know,
get a bigger sentence, right?
No, because nobody forced you to kill that guy.
Right.
So if I tell you to go kill somebody and you go do it.
Who's worse?
Because I told you to do it doesn't mean that I'm not going to get the time like you would. You committed the crime.
Right.
I said I would pay you money to kill somebody. So you made the choice and you planned out the way you were going to kill them. Or even if you planned it out with them, that's fine. But in the end,
who gets
you're
out
the
of
one
jail
that pulled
first?
The trigger. Probably the guy, probably this 19-year-old kid.
The kid who orchestrated it.
Versus the individual that did the murder, which
the muscle.
Again, they don't know who did it yet. Hmm. So this happened 4 days ago. I saw this on Fox News. I was like, wow, now that's
a true crime, an unsolved true crime.
And we're going to see how it comes. I'm going to continue to search this. And each week I hope to have some kind of
an update
on Nicholas Patrick Shaughnessy and Jacqueline Alex Edison. They're both from College Station.
Guys, don't kill your parents.
Nah, man, I don't care how big their life insurance policy is.
Dude, yeah.
Have some family love.
Bro. That's your parents, man.
Right.
But who knows? Who knows what this guy did to his son to make him hate him?
There's something to be said about this kid that, like, wow. What a classic millennial.
unwilling to work
for his dime. He's just like, you know what, kill my dad, he's gonna die one day, might as well just move up the date.
I'd like to cash the check.
I mean, the fact that this kid
he's taking one marshmallow, this kid,
right? The fact that this kid was killed, or the fact that this guy was murdered, like, it's too coincidental that he arranged to have it. And apparently in one of the other websites, it said that he had offered a cop $20,000 to do the murder, to do the hit.
Offered a cop?
Yeah, and they were waiting to, like, I don't know. I don't know how he got away with that, but whatever.
To jump on it?
Yeah.
In this day and age,
right?
Can you get away with murder with the internet? With all these true crime websites and, like, people who freak out about that stuff. Like, there's people who will just, like, research your case. They're not even detectives, but there's like groups. There's all kinds of of ways that they can track where you are, what you're doing through your phone, through the internet.
Right.
Like, how is anyone getting away with murder today? It baffles me.
I don't know.
Like, your phone is always on you.
Yeah.
You can't write anything down, and then you can't research anything because they'll just check your history.
Did you watch Evil Genius?
No, I didn't.
Oh, okay.
Not yet. Anyway. I'm going to. I promise you I will.
No worries.
Ready for a champ? Lighten things up?
Yeah, let's hear who this week's champion of the week could be.
The champion of the week. Yeah.
I'm going to do a choose your own adventure here.
Okay.
Do you want the celebrity champion or do you want the real world champion?
The real world champion. I don't ever want a celebrity champion.
Okay.
Because Benedict Cumberbatch saving somebody's life is not worth my time right now.
Oh, did you think that that's what I had?
I did, but I could be wrong. Was I right?
That was my celebrity champion.
Doctor Strange has done it again.
But it's okay. That's why I have a couple, you know? I got to mix it up. I got to not use the iPad for
this
man.
Shit. I don't know what the hell's going on with you over there. It's a slow response. We got too much dead air.
I'm getting all these
text messages. Why is there all this dead air? What's the deal with the dead air?
What's the dead air? All right. Here's the headline.
Okay.
Sweet video of an 8-year-old helping an elderly woman up the stairs will make your day.
Yes.
There's this video. It is delightful.
Oh, yes. This was on the Today Show. Yeah. Glad you took this from the Today Show.
Just
Savannah.
Just delightful. An 8-year-old Georgia boy jumped into action when he saw an elderly woman in need. Maurice Adams Jr., mm-hmm. You are the champion of the week.
Oh, sure.
He spotted this woman struggling to climb a flight of stairs on an outdoor path.
Yes.
In Milledgeville, Georgia. And it's just small little things. This kid, it's just a video of a little boy guiding an old woman up the steps.
Yes.
And just something as simple as that is enough to put a smile on your face, and that is beautiful.
It's a beautiful thing that, you know, this stuff, and you know, they said this on the Today Show. Hoda said this. Love Hoda. Big fan of Hoda. Hoda said, this stuff happens every day.
Yeah.
But we don't highlight it as much as we highlight things like, I have absolute power to pardon myself.
Right. What a piece of work. Would he stop? Would he stop the barricade? The motorcade to help this woman up the stairs?
Absolutely not.
Hell no.
As a matter of fact, he'd stop it to watch her fall down the stairs.
Yeah.
Anyway.
And what I also like, what some people haven't noticed, is after the kid gets this woman up the steps, he like leaps back down the steps and gets in the car. He gets in a car, and I think that is his parents' car.
Yeah, his mom just stopped him. She's so proud of her son.
Well, I think his parents saw and were like, go on, son.
Get out. Oh, you think so?
I think they're like, get out there, help that woman up the steps.
She said that he did that, that he wanted to stop.
He wanted to stop.
Yeah. Yeah, that's why he's our champion of the week, man.
Okay. All right. Well, he asked, guess I should have read the full article.
Read the article, bro.
He asked, can I go out there and help her up the steps? Hill told her son.
Hill told her son. What?
Hill said that before Maurice...
Her last name's Hill.
Yeah. What's up? Hill said that before Maurice returned to the car, the woman told him he's special. And damn it, he is.
Damn right. That guy just earned himself a full scholarship to Harvard right there.
I'll tell you what he needs to do.
What?
He needs to get on Ellen. You get on Ellen, son, if you know what's good for you. When you do something nice, you need to send a letter to Ellen, because Ellen going to get you college.
Yep.
She's going to get you some new clothes.
Oh, my God.
She's going to get you all the video games. She's going to figure out what celebrity you like. And guess what? That celebrity is going to be hanging out backstage. Is going to come out and surprise you and then give you more cool stuff.
Oh, my God. J.J. Watt.
Wow, it's really you.
It's really you, J.J. Watt.
Thanks.
Oh, my God.
It's the entire Atlanta Falcons. Hmm. So, Maurice Adams Jr., congratulations, homie. A little something goes a long way, and we can all learn something from this. Do something kind, even if it's really, really small.
Okay.
Because it'll make someone else's day.
Hmm.
Champion of the week.
Champion of the week. All right, man.
Well, gang, that was good.
Thanks for listening listening to the Dan and Cody podcast.
Oh, real quick.
And real quick, before we go, Dan's got something special he wants to say to you.
Real quick, Karma from the We Are Second Union. They asked if we're going to be at E3 or Comic-Con. I say yes to both.
Dan's going to be at both. Sounds interesting.
Cody, come to both. E3, I think E3 is in June.
Yeah, I think so.
And we should definitely do a podcast from Comic-Con. For
sure.
We show.
Should definitely do something like that. Yeah, if I'm at Comic-Con this year.
You're coming.
I don't know. I don't have a room.
You stay at my place.
I'll crash at your place again with Jenny and Moxie staying in there.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe I'll come up for a day. I don't like to.
Yeah, roll up,
Comic-Con's
man.
Comic-Con's just like a shit show.
It's tough.
It is tough, dude.
But we should go out there.
Are you guys ready?
We should throw out some stickers. No, we're not ready. I'm not even thinking about it yet.
That'll be coming up. It's June, buddy. You got 6 weeks.
Yeah.
Seriously. 6 weeks, bro.
Fuck.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, Warcraft might be done.
I'm knee-deep in Warcraft.
You're heading straight to Comic-Con before you know it. So.
That's right. That's right.
Anyway. All right, guys. Well, thanks for listening to the Dan and Cody podcast. We're thinking about you. Think about us and share us with your friends on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter.
We love you. We want to do you. Thanks for listening and laughing with the Dan and Cody podcast. Our email is danandcodypodcast@gmail.com. We're on Facebook. We're on Twitter. We are on Instagram @DanCodyPodcast. Check out our website, danandcody.com, and you can contribute to the podcast by going to patreon.com/DanCodyPodcast.
Subscribe, bitch!
Everybody play the tough guy and shit, all right?